Hey y'all wonderful YouTube people, welcome to my very first YouTube video. I am Tucker Trucker and this is Tucker Trucker Cryptid. I learned at a very young age that you have experiences that you don't know what's going on until you get older in your life and you start figuring it out. And when YouTube was born and people started putting a bunch of these videos and stories about their experiences on the internet, that made my eyes open up. And I started deep thinking about it. And the next thing I knew, it was coming out. And I have listened to Steve from How to Hunt. I think he's got a great channel bringing all this out in the open. There's a lot of doubters out there. I have another channel I really like, and it's David Paulides. I want to make sure I get his name right. I watch his channel a lot, and a lot of these missing people I think have to do with cryptids and UFOs and all kinds of stuff people just, back when I was growing up, couldn't even imagine is really true. And I've done a lot of research on this in the last several years. And my eyes are open. I've been red-pilled, I guess you might say. Been red-pilled in a whole lot of ways other than, you know, government stuff. And yeah, it's really deep. Yeah. But anyway, I wanted to tell you some stories. Start off my YouTube channel with some cryptid stories about things that happened to me when I was younger. And as I age, things happen over again and different things happen, and I'm going to get to those, but I'm going to start out in the beginning. And when I was about 4 years old, we moved to California. My daddy was a veteran of the U.S. military. I'm also a U.S. military veteran, and I want to thank all the veterans out there for your service. But we moved to California, and we got together with a whole bunch of folks who were outdoors type of people, and they had boats, and we had a nice boat, and we all would go camping together. And we were stationed in Sacramento, California, and not too awfully far from Sacramento is the Folsom Prison, with a huge lake called Folsom Lake. Johnny Cash sang a song about that, Folsom Prison, yeah. And we'd get in our boats and launch them into the lake and load up all our camping gear, and several families, we'd go zooming across the lake for up to an hour, take us to get, you know, or more sometimes, depending on what section of the lake, you know, we decided to camp at. But it was mountains going up from, you know, the water edge, and we'd try to find, you know, a place that was sandy beach type area, you know. Sometimes it's just rocky areas, but yeah, we'd set up camp, and then all us kids would just be roaming up and down the mountain without no parental guidance and just off on our own, and Lord knows what was up there watching all of us, you know. But at night, things come up missing out of our campground, food and drinks and stuff like that. And oh, all the parents, they blame all us kids. Oh, y'all are, you know, sneaking out and eating the food up and sneaking out and drinking the drinks and everything's disappearing. And us kids wasn't doing it, I can tell you now. We all kids would gather up going, hey, what are they blaming this on us for, you know? But I'm pretty sure we had Sasquatches sneaking around. We had one guy with us. He was a single guy. Didn't have a wife and family at the time. And he's passed away now, so I guess I can say his name. Mr. Ballinger. And he decided he wasn't having his food stolen by us kids. He's going to hang his cooler way up in a tree. So he ran him some ropes over the limbs and hoisted that cooler way up high. And well, the next night or the next day, he didn't have no food. The cooler was torn down. Ropes was broke. So, contrary to popular belief, it wasn't no bear that reached that far up in that tree that he had that cooler hoisted up there. And I'm pretty sure it was a Bigfoot Sasquatch. Now, we didn't see anything. We didn't hear a whole lot, you know. But, I mean, all the dads, they was drinking their beer and sleeping hard. And one night we did hear some weird stuff. And, everybody, we could hear all the other people in the tents. They was waked up too and was listening to all that, scuffling around outside in the campground. Whoever it was out there was going through everything. But when we'd look out the tent, we never did really see anything. My dad had a flashlight, and he flickered it around out there, and things would be quiet, and then we'd all go back to sleep and hear some more sounds out there. But anyway, it is what it is, and that's what it was. We got many places that we've lived around the country, and I had, after we left California, we went to, back to Mobile, Alabama, and my daddy went to Vietnam for a year, and we lived in Mobile through 1969 through Hurricane Camille, and that was an ordeal and a half. But after Dad come back from Vietnam, we moved to Missouri, and we did some camping up there, but I don't really remember anything, you know, happening up there that was mention worthy. But then we moved to Michigan, and then a lot more weird stuff happened while we was camping up and around about in that area. Go on, Zoo. I'm videoing, darling. Go. Go. Good boy. Go. And so we was up there camping. We would go up Lake Ausable out to wilderness areas. We would follow Lake Ausable. Or Ausable River, actually. The Ausable River empty out into the Lake Huron there. And Michigan, let's say my hand is Michigan. We was in Oscoda, Michigan, which would be about right there, with Detroit being right down in this area right here. And we would take Ausable River to, I can't remember the name of that lake, but the river had some tributaries that went up off of the lake, and we'd take one of them up and go till real far up into the wilderness. And several families that lived around us on the base and that my father worked with, we'd get together with our boats, take our families, and go out there for weekends and holidays and all kind of stuff. Well, this one particular time, we was way far out on a point that kind of went around a bend, and we set up camp there and everything. We had this miniature poodle that our family pet, and his name was Rebel. Well, Rebel heard something up in the woods, and he commenced to barking like crazy. Something, he was going to get him. He ran at the woods and barked real hard, and something growled at him. And that dog tore back out, and he come past us, went into the tent, and that's where he stayed. He wouldn't come out of there. And then one of the other men that was camping with us, oh my God, it's a bear. Oh, and then they put every one of us kids, made us climb up in a tree, was hoisting us all up there. All us kids was climbing up the trees, wondering one of us didn't fall out and break our neck. But we was up, told by our parents, climb up that tree. And I don't know what they was going to do, but anyway, time passed, and seemingly the threat, you know, passed, and they pulled us all down out of the tree, and then it was time to go to bed, so they put everybody in the tent and made them go to sleep. Well, I'm laying in the tent, and I was so ramped up, I couldn't sleep for worth of nothing, and that man came over to our campsite where the fire was, and he was talking to my dad, and he told my dad, and I overheard this, he said, "Jim, if that was a bear, that was the biggest bear I've ever seen." And he said, "And I've done a lot of hunting," he said, "and I have never seen a bear get up and walk, run, you know, take off on its hind legs like that." And he said, "That was just a huge animal." And him and my dad discussed it for a little while, and my dad said, "Well, you sure you think that's what you saw, you know, and all this and that and the other." Well, nothing was ever said to us kids about it, you know, but that's just something that stuck with me all these years. I must have been 10 or 11 at that time, probably about 11, but anyway. And so my dad retired, you know, from the military, and we moved to Louisiana out in the boonies again. Got us a farm. Oh, yeah, we was out near the Kisatchie National Forest there in the England Air Force Base area, Alexandria, Louisiana. We was just north of there. We went to Dry Prong High School with all them country kids, yeah. And I had quite a few experiences where I'm pretty sure I came across some Sasquatches, Bigfoots. And I'm going to tell you a few of them stories. One of them, we used to have our cars, and everybody was countrified, and everybody had their CB radios. And so I got me a CB radio in my car, too. I bought my dad's 66 Plymouth Fury one with no air conditioner. Hot summertime down there in Louisiana. And we used to play this game. I can't remember what we called it, but there wasn't even 40 channel radios. Then there was only 20 channel radios. And we'd get on a certain channel. Everybody'd get on the same channel. And you turn your squelch all the way up. And you drive around out in the Kisatchie National Forest at night until you found one another through the squelch on the radio. And a lot of people would be zooming. There's dirt roads all over the place. You're zooming all through there, you know. Now, some of them were, you know, didn't want to be found. They turned their headlights off, be zooming down the, you know, dirt road, no headlights on. But you could tell if they went by because the dust would be flying up everywhere. And so I pulled off the road and was waiting to see if I could see some taillights coming or something, you know. And had the windows all rolled down, you know, so we could get some air conditioning that way. And I waited a little while, was listening on the radio and didn't hear nobody. So I flipped my headlights back on and was going to take off zooming again. And something went across the road in front of me. And it was very big, dark colored, full of hair all over it. I didn't get to see, you know, its face, but it, you know, from the research I've done from the last several years, it was Bigfoot. No doubt in my mind, that's what it was. And boy, I floored it. I left some dust in that place, and I hightailed it onto the house. I'd had enough of that game for that night. Another incident, me and some friends, we went to a place called Chandler Branch. And it was like a little creek that run, you know, through the middle of nowhere, the woods, and there was a cut off with some dirt roads going to the creek, you know, and we'd go down there in the summer and, you know, get wet in the water and cool off and sit on the hood of our car, leaned up against the windshield, listen to the radio, you know, talk, have a few beers or whatever. And we got down there this one day, and there was a bunch of other people down there who was older than us. But they was been drinking for a while down there, obviously, and they was pretty spent. And there was this one guy, he was kind of out of control, and he told us all his name was Coonass. Well, he got fresh with one of my friends, and it started a bunch of ruckus, and she ended up pulling a gun on him and telling him he needed to leave. Well, he got real mad and cussed us all out and jumped in his vehicle with his friends, and they left. And we stayed there, and it got dark, and we were still there listening to the radio, you know, in the car, leaning up on the hood against the windshield and listening to the creek, you know, flowing through there. And just a little ways down from us, to our right, we heard heavy, heavy footsteps. And then bump down across the creek and up the other side and up off into the woods. And one of the girls said, "You reckon that Coonass has come back here to try to scare us?" So we all decided, yeah, that's what it was. So we figured we better leave, you know, before any trouble started. And so we got in the car and we drove away. But I'm going to tell you right now, that man who told us that his name was Coonass, that man was not big enough to make no footfalls like what we heard come across the road down in with the area near us, across that creek, up the hill, and on. That man wasn't near big enough to make that kind of sound walking. So, I'm pretty sure it was Bigfoot. And, you know, just so much evidence, duh, you have to figure it out or you're really stupid. So that's just, hey, I'm just calling it like I see it, you know. And this video is already 17 minutes. Oh, gosh, I've got quite a few other stories. But you know what? I'm just going to try to keep it short. And I'm going to stop for now, and I'll do some more videos. If you like the content of my video and you want to hear more, click the thumbs up button, and you can subscribe to my channel and click the little bell icon like they say to do, and you can be notified when my other videos come up. And if you have a video that story or an email story that you want to write and send me, I will put my information below in the box down there, and you can email me your story if you'd like, and I'll read your story on a line if you want. I'll be glad to do that, because I've got some more stories coming, but I'm sure my stories eventually are going to run out. And if you want me to tell your story, I'll be more than happy to, because I want this to come out in the open. I'm like Steve with How to Hunt, and I know that Mr. Paulides, he knows this stuff is real. And it's been happening. People, 911 missing come up. I think Mr. Paulides has a fabulous channel. And I want to give kudos to him and Steve and a bunch of other people that are telling the truth on all these cryptid story videos. Because people need to know about these things. And the government's been hiding it from us, no doubt, for a long, long time. So, thank you again for watching my channel. Y'all take care. God bless. See you next time.